Anyway, my name's Cameron Gleeson. I'm doing a special for this week, and a very special, special, special it is, because it actually goes until 7 o'clock tonight. But at 6 o'clock tonight, we'll be playing one of the things that I've done in my life, which required the greatest amount of effort and the greatest, or probably the greatest amount of initiative of all the things I've ever done. And that, in fact, is a radio documentary that goes for half an hour. And it's about a Melbourne-based group called the Cave Clan. And if you don't know anything about them, they're people who actually explore the stormwater drains in Melbourne, and have been likened to bands such as the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, being branded with things such as Subaltern and Deviant, anything like that. Anyway, all the information's in the half hour, starting at 6 o'clock tonight.
Hello, I'm Tim Hassett, and I'm here to introduce a documentary made with Cameron Gleeson about a group called the Cave Clan. Cameron made contact with this group some time ago and has ventured into their world to investigate who they are and what these urban explorers do. To begin with, however, let's hear what people in the street think the Cave Clan are.
The books.
What are they, band or...?
No, because I'm from Germany.
Yeah, well, I don't know, like, anyone in the group sort of thing, but, yeah. I think, yeah, well, they're just young guys armed with texters.
So, who are this group, the Cave Clan? We went in search of them, and it turned out to be a fascinating journey.
Right, yeah, I've heard, like, on the news from time to time, you know, kids or, you know, whatever, getting caught down in the storm water drains and so on, yeah, yeah.
So there is a perception out there that this is simply a group of young children entering the drains to imitate the Ninja Turtles. As we will hear later, the Cave Clan members are concerned to correct this view and to discourage this kind of activity. They seek publicity to counter the view held by Melbourne Water that they are irresponsible and encourage imitators. Some members of the general public are getting the Cave Clan's message, it seems.
Just a group of guys hang around in the sewers of Melbourne, and a big sort of a club and very well organised, and I often see their address around on stickers, and they have a postbox number. And
even this well-informed view is not quite right. The Cave Clan never enter the sewers. They only explore the stormwater drains, and so we thought we'd start our search for the truth about them there.
Here we are in the tunnel, and we've got on the wall here, we've got Clan Inc. 26 of the first 86. We've got Founders, Woody, Sloth, Duggo. And as you can hear the train going overhead, it's pretty slippery on the floor here, so it's a bit hard to walk along. And I'm finding it a bit hard to keep my balance, and it's getting darker and darker as we're going in. We've got a bit of refuse on the floor here. Apparently it's not far up here, about a 3-minute walk up to where we're going to meet these guys at this major cavern. Anyway, it's the floor seems to be getting a bit drier, but it's still a bit slippery, and as I've noticed, I'm wearing completely the wrong footwear, but I actually do have a torch on me. We've got names on both sides here: Gilligan, Mosh, Aspro, Razor. I'm watching out here above my head in case there's something I might bump into. Don't think I'm really in for this drain exploring kind of stuff as I thought I might have been when I took on this job. And we're coming up to a bend in the tunnel there. I think at the start of the tunnel we had red bricks in a sort of an archway, which is probably, well, it's sort of like a half circle moon shape. And that would have been about, oh, I don't know. And I've taken a fall. It's all right though. And that would, well, I suppose the tunnel would be about 12, 14 foot across, And anyway, we've lost all the names on the side. You can see a bit of light up there. So it looks like we're coming to this much talked about cavern.
The cavern that Cameron was in appeared to be some sort of nerve centre. There was even a notice board with previous media writings plastered onto the concrete. On the far wall, Cameron saw what he thought were louvers for ventilation, but changed his mind when he saw from underneath people walking up and down what was actually a
staircase that leads up, and you can see the staircase going somewhere, and it goes onto the street, cars driving by. There's a house with number 12 on it. It's not actually Chapel Street, but it's somewhere underneath the vicinity of Melbourne High School. This must be the headquarters, I think, or like the clubhouse or whatever. Anyway, I'm pretty keen to get out of here. You can probably hear the sound of the drain as we're walking along it. Just making my way out now. Well, I'm just coming around the bend now, and in a minute I should be able to see the proverbial light at the end of the tunnel. Yeah, and there's actually someone coming down here. You can see. Yo, Duggo!
Cameron's first experience of their domain left him convinced that draining was not for him. Now it seems it was time for the cave clan to speak for themselves. The figure who appeared out of the darkness of the tunnel turned out, in fact, to be Duggo, who was accompanied by a number of the other Cave Clan members. And although he had arranged to meet them there, they were not at this time comfortable to speak with Cameron on tape. It was agreed, therefore, that they would meet later at a pub. What follows now is that interview between Duggo, Cameron, and some other members of the clan who are identified only by their tags or clan names.
We're assembled here with some of the members, and they're going to give us some of their thoughts on the Cave Clan.
A group of people who mainly the only thing they have in common really is the fact that they like exploring inner urban dark places, I suppose you call it, underground, or not, you know, like under roads and that, under bridges and anything underground, except for sewers, because they're full of turds and that. Yeah, I suppose it's changed over the years. Originally it was just underground exploration once every month or so. It's become more of a social thing sort of now, like a lot of, I suppose there's more of a social side to it. There's a few social gatherings and parties and that, where the old days it was just, it was more of a joke sort of thing in the old days. The name was, we called Cave Clan because when we started off we were going to do caves and all that, but over the years it's got sidetracked, I suppose, and ended up sort of the more alternative types of things to explore. But yeah, so it's basically just, you know, urban exploration. Some people think that means more than what it is, but I mean, the people now, they do a lot more than I ever did. Like when we started, it was like once every month, no more than that, and there's people nowadays, I'll be doing like a couple of tunnels a week, and you know, I'd never have done that. And I mean, it's a bit easier, I suppose, because they've got a list now where they can just pin what they want to do and go and do it. They know which ones are good and which ones are shit. Like, if we didn't do one for a month or so, and we go do one and it turned out being a really poor one, we'd that'd put us right off, you know, and then it'd take a while before we get enthusiastic. Plus, we didn't realise there were so many around. The inner suburban areas, I suppose you'd say 99% of it has been done. Outer suburbs, a lot have been found like over the years, but they're not recorded. We don't, because they're not up to standard. They're just, like, not big enough or not interesting enough. So they'll get found, they're re-found, sort of. People think, I found a new one out so-and-so, but in most cases they've been found. As you get out to Belgrave and way out, there may be some, but we haven't really found a decent new drain for, you know, or let's say a top 20 drain in Melbourne for a long time. When we have the awards, we have a yearly awards night at Clanny's. That's the only way you can tell which ones are more popular. But no, we don't have an official top 20. It varies too much. Like, he likes waterfalls, and he doesn't like the light. Some people like sections where heaps of light get in. Some people like the red bricks. There used to be a guy, Matt, he likes the red brick tunnels and bluestone. He's a photographer and he likes the colours. So it'd be very hard to rate, you know. Like, but we generally know which are the top best 10, but we don't have an official list.
You don't like to disclose maps and things. You like to let people discover their own way around the tunnels, is that right?
It's like going to a football match and knowing the results before, you know, before the game, sort of thing. Like, it's like, you don't want to, you just say, look, it's a good one, go and do it, but you don't want to really tell them, let them find it out for themselves what's in there.
How many people are in the cave clan?
There's about 60 in the cave clan. There's a lot of variation in the level of activity. Some people do four or five drains a week. Some do four or five a year. Some do even less than that, but still consider themselves part of the cave clan. There's an unofficial meeting each week at a Hare Krishna restaurant in the city. 10 or 12 would be a good turnout for that. It's sort of a hardcore group of about 20, I suppose, who are the active people, and about 40 who are around but not very active. I've only met about 20 people in the clan, mostly at I went to a party, and I went to a couple of expos, which are mass drain exploring things where clan people and others are invited along. Anyone who's written to the clan post office box and said they'd like to go and drains gets invited to the next expo. So it's typically half and half, clan people and those sort of people at an expo. So that's mostly where I've met them.
Well, it depends if you're in the mood or not. Like, sometimes we might do three a week and then might leave it for a month or so, and just until we're in the mood. Depends on the weather as well.
Upset about having a woman there, and they make a point shown continuously over and over again.
There may be a fight shortly.
And sometimes I feel I have to prove myself more, and
paranoid.
It's just very difficult sometimes. But occasionally I do things on my own a lot more generally, because the guys tend to be physically stronger than me, so they tend to do things kind of a lot more, and they don't appreciate things the way I do.
All right, so you seem pretty keen. You've got your maps marked in your melways and stuff like that. Do you find that's a long process, discovering drains for yourself?
When I first joined up, the first few months I spent mostly going around looking for drains for myself. I didn't really bother in going in actual marked maps, but it's only kind of like the last few months, since May or July, that I've actually gone out and done the marked maps, and so I've kind of like, that's when I really picked up and went into kind of high gear and did at least about two a week sometimes.
All right, so how long have you been in the cave clan for?
Technically since March. I kind of joined in early February. I wrote in, but it wasn't until a couple of months ago that anyone ever said I was in the cave clan. I didn't even know. I thought they'd forgotten all about me. Then I got a phone, and he says, "Oh, I saw your name around a bit," and I thought, "Oh, God!" And I didn't really know. I thought that's the end. So most of the time, most of the joins I've been doing, I've just been doing for myself. It wasn't because of the cave clan or anything like that.
So you say you do drains yourself. Is there any way that you can stake your claim that you've actually been in one? Like, do you leave a signpost or paint your name on the wall or anything?
I usually write my tag on the wall. My tag's the alien. It's kind of, it's gotten around a few times now, about 40 drains around the place now. So people can usually tell you, just write your name probably on the entrance, probably next to manhole side covers, and probably down near the end, and that's probably where I'll write it, so on the wall.
January, Australia Day, 1986. Although didn't really start on that day, that's where we sort of thought it'd be a good idea to do something like that, and then we sort of didn't get a name for a couple of months. Then we did about 4 drones in the first 8 months. And we were doing other things like mines and anything we could sort of do. But, the cave plan didn't start off until, I think, the actual name, came up with the name when we did our first drone, which was October 86. But we, you know, we still considered ourselves some kind of group and toyed around with names, but even once we had the name, it was still wasn't such a... We never put stickers or added stickers or anything like that, or it was just a joke, something to do sort of thing. And the names, like, although what we did, we didn't take as a joke, but the name side of it was just, you know, sort of it was a joke totally. You know, we never thought it'd take off or anything like that.
At the conclusion of Cameron's first meeting with the Cave Clan, it was already clear that this was not a group of foolhardy young people. They were serious about their exploration of Melbourne's drains. So, what of the view that this is not only an illegal activity, but a dangerous one? Melbourne Water, the group which owns these drains, were approached to put their point of view. However, they refused to comment. A spokesperson said that Melbourne Water were no longer prepared to give the Cave Clan publicity, believing that the more that they got, the more imitators would be encouraged into the drains. To obtain a view on the safety aspects of draining, we approached the Metropolitan Fire Brigade for comment and spoke to Peter Quincy, a district officer.
My understanding would be that they take some pleasure in finding their way through the myriad of tunnels and caves or stormwater drains which honeycomb under the city of Melbourne. I would, for example, not like my children to be doing it, simply because I know from my own professional experience the dangers which can be involved in drains and stormwater drains and those sorts of places. The risks, I suppose, are considerable. They can range from flash flooding, which, as a lot of people won't understand, can occur from rain which is quite considerable distance from where they are. The fact is that the drains are all intertwined and flooding in one area is not necessary.
It's good to bring another person along with you, because if you fall off a ladder, at least someone's going to come and help you. But
well, mostly you just check up manholes, because if you want to bail out, you can just jump out into the street or something.
there's always a possibility that someone could fall, hit their head, break a leg, and be some considerable distance down one of these pipes from an area where they could be rescued.
I reckon the only danger is, obviously, if it's going to rain, then we just say if it's going to rain, no drains. But really the only danger is if you slip over, because it is slippery. And I think,
yeah, I noticed it was slippery on the way in. If you have a look at me, my ass there, it's got a big wet patch on it.
Yeah, you learn that the first time and never slip over again. Yeah. But the only danger is like bumping your heads and slipping over.
Metropolitan Fire Brigade is charged with the protection of life and property within the metropolitan area. As such, we respond to any call for assistance, and we would take this as any other call, as a rescue call. Appliances would be dispatched. They'd weigh up the situation. They'd call for whatever professional knowledge they could get from the Board of Works, or Melbourne Water as it is now, to get drainage plans and that sort of thing. Possibly police to block off areas, and the Metropolitan Fire Brigade would coordinate a search if required. As a general rule, we don't make moral judgments about how people got into the circumstance that they're in. As an individual, I'm sure that the crews who had to put their own time and their own effort into, and in some cases risk their own lives for something which was at best avoidable, I'm sure that they would be less than impressed.
You may well wonder, going down drains, you may think, oh, well, go down drains, all right, how boring. People probably think going down drains is just boring, and what's the point? There's a whole lot of different things you see down there which you'd never think you'd see if you never go in. Mega stairways in Burwood or Hartwell, and if you walk in there, it's just a kind of sort of a what they call it, mummy shape. It's more of a semicircular horseshoe sort of shape arch. Now that's just the entrance, as sort of an aqueduct creek goes into it. Now you walk in there, you'd never think there was anything else up there, but you walk in about 20 minutes and you get to a huge stairway, about 9 or 10 steps. You have to walk up it if you walk in from the Hartwell end, because it's flowing down. Yeah, I'm just about it. So you'd never expect that. So there's really interesting things up there, things like that, staircases and all sorts of things.
I suppose any precautions that they take is of a benefit to them. You can't wear helmets on your leg if you slip or break that. You can't wear an aqua lung in case there's a flash flood. So while they take some precautions, I'm sure they're only band-aid precautions in a way.
Yeah. Cord, I suppose, if you don't know what you're doing. Just take something warm because it gets cold. It's starting to get a little bit cool here now. And that's all. Just take food. Take a drink of water and food, or a can of Coke or beer or something. But on the point of darkness, it's pretty dumb if you don't take a spare battery or a spare torch. I have a big torch and then also one small mag light. So if one breaks down, you know you've got something to go by.
With Night Stalker now, and he's going to talk to us about the cave clan too. We're at the entrance to the tunnel here on the Yarra River, and as you can hear the traffic in the background. So you're one of the seasoned people. You must know the inside of a few drains.
Oh yeah, quite a few, yeah.
What's the best thing you've found in a drain?
Well, found a whole lot of dead animals, but apart from that, just talking features, there's all sorts of things. I mean, most drains are the average round cement, say 6 foot, 7 foot high, but they get up to, there's a 15, 16 foot drain, which is a great big archway, and there's square drains, arches, yeah, rectangles, all sorts of things like that.
Coffin shape, sort of mummy shape, balloon, egg shape.
Okay, we got Doug over here. He's going to tell us about underneath St. James Station in Sydney.
These 30-foot high chambers, about 100 foot wide, and they've all got zigzag sort of rooms, so if there's an explosion, the hot corridors that join them up are sort of zigzag, so the blast won't go through to the other chamber. There's about 8 chambers in a row. on the other side of the station, which is where the other where the train tunnel was going to go also. It's just naturally, like they've bored through, they haven't cemented the sides of that. And there's one part that's sort of flooded. It's just like a permanent lake. It's under Hyde Park, actually, in Sydney. And, yeah, and there's guys that swim in it and that do a bit of, in the summer they swim in it. When we went to go through to the lake, the guys on the train station chased us. So we got to the lake and then we realised unless we were going to go for a swim, we wouldn't get through. But just near the lake there's an access into the, and just a doorway that goes into the actual train tunnels, which is a bit scary, like they were still going. And in Sydney the trains go every like 5 minutes. So then we were bolting along the train, these train tunnels, and, you know, sort of just got out near Circular Quay, which is, you know, their city where all the, it's one of the main spots in the city, and jumped off the, hung down and jumped off the train line, which is about sort of 12 feet up. And then about a minute later, the train came flying out. So.
Anything like that in Melbourne that you know of, like under bridges or something like that?
There's plenty of like bridge rooms and that, where bridges that are just hollow, and some of them are like 30 foot high chambers sort of thing. Other ones are just a lot smaller. Other ones will be blocked off and have like, just have little holes in the wall, like 16 rooms. There's one called Gas Chamber, 16 rooms. It's a bridge room you get in, and then there's one, a corridor, and as you go along, there's all rooms that split off and junctions. And but not, there's not really big chamber-like things. There's sewage treatment plants, which are normally pretty clean. It's just when the pumping stations break down for whatever reason, the water, the sewage builds up and flows into it. And then normally, the one that we did in Baldwin was about, you know, 20 foot high, 25 foot high, and about 30 metres diameter. Like, it was pretty big. But we left a bit of graffiti there, and the border works really said, oh, you shouldn't go in there, that's, you know, more dangerous than drains and all this sort of shit. When we got caught putting up the stickers by the police in Sydney, they sort of said, you know, have you been in these tunnels, have you been in that those tunnels? And we said, no. And he goes, oh, you should call yourself tunnel explorers. This is tunnel. We also made up a sticker at the time, which was just a joke, sort of, because a lot of people were saying, oh, you know, oh, you think you're smart putting the stickers up, egotistic bastard. So we made up these stickers that said, you know, cave clan have whopping big dongs and lots of cash, which is just, you know, sort of, you know, which is what people reckon. We put the stickers up basically saying stuff like that. So, and we had them on us. Luckily the police didn't see them on us, you know. They only saw the interested in tunnels.
Why do I do it? I like it. I can't, it's very hard to be more specific than that. It's adventurous, it's different, it's out of the sanitised entertainment that the world's full of. It's something something rebellious and alternative about it, and it's fun.
Documentary entitled The Cave Clan there, and that was produced, edited, directed, and yelled at by Tim Hassett and myself, Cameron Gleeson. We spent a lot of time pulling each other's hair out and yelling at each other. I'd just like to say thanks a lot for that, Tim. I think the whole thing spoke for itself anyway. Thanks to Superna, Olivia, Lucy, and Aaron, and everyone else who rang up to comment about the Cave Clan and everything that was going on in that documentary. If you want some more information about the cave, sorry I haven't been on air for the last 15 minutes, but it's because I've had so many phone calls, but it's tough being popular. Anyway, if you want some more information about the Cave Clan, just write to PO Box 268 and they'll send you any kind of information you require about draining or whatever. And the postcode is 3067.